Finding your seats. We are going to be continuing our journey through the book of Galatians. So if you do have your Bibles, please open them to the book of Galatians. And specifically, we're going to be opening them to chapter 5, verses 15 through 25 today. So it's again, Galatians 5, 15 through 25, as we talk about keeping in step with the Spirit. So I'll go ahead and read the passage for us, and then we'll go ahead and dive into today's message. So verse 15 of Galatians chapter 5 says this, "But if you bite and devour one another, watch out that you are not consumed by one another." And now notice the juxtaposition with which Paul starts the next verse, verse 16. "But I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit, and the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh. For these are opposed to each other to keep you from doing the things that you want to do. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are evident: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like these. I warn you, as I warned those before you, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control, and against such things there is no law. And those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. And so if we live by the Spirit, let us also walk by the Spirit." And we'll stop there. What a wonderful portion of scripture that we have to study this morning. Galatians 5, 15 through 25 just has this amazing stark contrast in it, where you see not only how people who are outside of the Spirit, how they operate, and that could be all of us, right? How all of us can potentially operate if we're not under the Spirit. And then that great stark contrast of those who are living in the Spirit, those who have the Spirit, and how they act. And so I just wanted to begin again with a division that we've been talking about for the last couple of weeks, and that is the difference between the temple model and the grace model, because this is something that Paul doesn't say explicitly in his epistle, but it's something that maybe can help you theoretically or conceptually understand the difference between those things. Again, there's two kinds of religion. And again, this isn't just two kinds of Christianity, but religion in general. The temple model and the grace model. And I don't need to go throughout everything, but since we do have some guests here and some people who haven't been journeying with us through this study through the book of Galatians, again, the temple model is where you have a sacred space governed by sacred rules, given by sacred priests that create scared people, right? Not sacred people, but scared people. Because you don't know if you're going to mess up. And that's true of Hinduism, that's true of Buddhism, that's true of Islam, that's true of Judaism, and sadly, it's true of some sects of Christianity. So that some sects of Christianity will have people who are a little bit scared because they feel like they have to perform and that God is measuring their performance. And that's in contrast to the grace model, where it's all about Jesus and it's all about his merit given to us whereby we're righteous. And so in the grace model, in the temple model, rather, you could see this nice little division here. You've got a system, and this system, it needs rigorous adherence. If you don't adhere to it 100%, well, then you fail the whole thing. It requires a perfect score. And what it results in is self-absorption, because, after all, it's really all about what I do and how well I perform. And that really is so counterintuitive to the gospel, right? Because we end up feeling like what we do rather than what God has done through his Jesus' finished work on the cross is the most important thing about us. And that's, of course, in contrast to the grace model, where it's not about a system. Instead, it's about a Savior. And that Savior is the one who effects or brings about our salvation. And that results, of course, in self-forgetfulness. Now, One of the things that I wanted to establish, and one of the reasons why I think that what we're going to read about today and what we're going to study today is probably one of the most important lessons through the book of Galatians, is this. Because what I've been trying to establish, and the point that I've been trying to drive home for the last few months as we've made our way through this book, is this. The temple model doesn't work. And we all know this intuitively, but we still sort of need that reminder. The temple model doesn't work, because what the temple model promises is precisely what it can't deliver, and that is that your righteousness can just be a product of your relentless effort. Now, that has been thoroughly refuted by what Paul has written and what we've studied, and also by our experience. But the question might arise, well then, should we not even try? Like, does God not even care about me being righteous? Where does spiritual formation fit into this whole thing? Where do we understand that God calls us, when we're Christians, not just to get a get-out-of-hell-free card, but actually to become conformed into the image of his son, Jesus? And so some people, misunderstanding the book of Galatians, maybe not reading it all the way through, will come and kind of go, what? This is great. Like, this is so cool. Like, I'm so glad that you unpacked this for me, because now I know that I don't need to try. And it's like, uh-oh, wait, that's not what Paul is trying to say. Just because the temple model doesn't work doesn't mean that you can't become righteous. It doesn't mean that you can't become more holy. It doesn't mean that you can't become increasingly conformed into the image of Christ. You can become conformed more into the image of Christ. And whereas you'll never achieve perfection on this side of heaven, you should still strive for those things. But the way that you strive for them, ready, is not through the temple model, but through the grace model. And that's what we're going to talk about today. Now, again, we all know this, but it takes a very strategic approach. And we need to first dispel the myth and the bad ideas about the fact that, yes, we can achieve holiness just by virtue of our efforts. No, that's not true. But we also need to, in the same breath and out of the same side of our mouth, say, yes, we can achieve holiness, but it's not by virtue of what we do, but instead by virtue of what the Holy Spirit does, and us working alongside of and synergistically with the Holy Spirit. That's what this passage is going to be all about. And so I hope that you guys will stick with me. I hope that you guys will, like, understand this in a way that will contribute to your spiritual growth, because this is so incredibly important. And I'm here so indebted to Tim Keller, who's a pastor out in New York. I don't agree with everything that he has to say, and yet the guy is just amazingly brilliant and really, really talented. And so he, in his writings, talks about this, what you need, or what I need to know to change. And he talks about this, and he says, there's the organic nature of change. Now, think about that way. Think about that word, rather. The word organic, it doesn't just refer to, like, what you buy at the store. But organic can refer to something that's not forced. Like, if we're going to have, like, a really deep conversation, me and you, like, it probably won't happen in a crowd of people that you don't trust. That same conversation of deep trust and where you want to confide something will probably happen organically if we were to be alone, maybe over coffee or a meal, and we unpack kind of the layers, we do some small talk, and then that happens organically. Well, that's the usage of the word here that Keller means and that I mean when I'm talking about the organic nature of change. It means it's not forced. It means that it's not just a result of me putting my head down and just trying. Even though there is effort when we talk about these things, it's not outside of what the Holy Spirit is doing. It is precisely because of what the Holy Spirit's doing. And this organic nature of change, what we have in order to become like Christ, it happens in four ways, okay? But the first one that I want to focus on today is that change is gradual. Now think about this for a minute, okay? So as Paul is unpacking this, and as Paul is talking about all of these spiritual changes, first let's just go back and talk about the works of the flesh. Now look with me at verse 19 in chapter 5. Now the works of the flesh are evident. sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalry, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the things like these. I warn you, as I warned those before, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Now, you might read that list and kind of go, wow, that kind of sounds like my neighbor, right? But instead of that being like a handy judgment list that you can keep in your back pocket and go, you know, and kind of what we should instead understand is that whereas all of these might not be true of us, probably one of these might be true of us. Would you agree? And I'm not trying, I'm including myself here, okay? But there, I look at this list, and honestly, I am not struggling with orgies. Like, I'm just not. That's not a thing. But, you know, do I ever have problems with fits of anger? Yeah. Do I ever, you know, have envy? Yeah. You know, do I ever have, you know, thoughts about, you know, the fact that, no, that person doesn't deserve it, but I do? Yeah, those are things that I struggle with. And so you all have things, the works of the flesh, and also, by the way, if you're reading out of an NIV, it probably says the works of the sinful nature. And we could talk about that maybe afterwards. I don't know that that's the best translation of the Greek word sarx, but here in this passage, you see that these things are almost sort of intuitive to you. They're natural to you. They're almost organic to you, okay? And here's also what I mean. You've heard me say this example before, but I didn't have to sit down with Jane or Luke and say, now, you guys ready? Daddy's going to teach you a very important lesson. Here's how to be selfish. Mine! Like, I never had to do that. Ever. And yet, they developed a very robust sense of selfishness within their first couple years of life. I never had to teach them that. I never had to teach them anger. I never had to teach them jealousy. I never had to teach them, you know, to overeat on sweets or something like that. That was natural. You guys following what I'm saying? So, how do we then change from what's natural? And how then does that change become or come about naturally? That's where Paul sort of transitions in verse 22 to the fruit of the Spirit. And notice, he uses a very specific metaphor. And this is not one that we should overlook. He doesn't use something abstract like, you know, here's the concepts of the Spirit. He says something very concrete like fruit. And all of us understand what fruit is. And yet, interestingly enough, very few of us understand how fruit is grown. Now, I have the opposite of a green thumb. Like, I can kill any plant. I could somehow, some way kill a plastic plant. I don't even know. But, like, Sarah and I will buy, like, basil from the store, you know, that's like, you know, and we've tried to grow it how many times? Probably like 15 times, and it just inevitably dies. But there are some people in here that are really good at growing. And there are so many lessons about growing fruit or growing vegetables or growing trees that are applicable to Jesus' message. And that's because Jesus was the most phenomenal storyteller of all time, and he was super intriguing. And when he taught, he used examples that people could grasp. And walking around Israel 2,000 years ago in first century Palestine, where they would, you know, have Second Temple Judaism and all that stuff, where you would walk, there were fruit trees, there were fig trees. There were all kinds of different plants and things. And so Jesus, as he walked, a peripatetic teacher, that is, he walked as he taught a lot of times, as rabbis would, they would see fruit and they would point out certain things about these fruits. And they would point out certain things about fruit that wouldn't grow and why it was that it wouldn't grow. And he would use analogies about seed that was put on hard ground or seed that was eaten up by birds that didn't ever have the chance to grow, or some seed that grew, but just because of the heat of the sun, it died earlier than it should have. And so this is a world, in short, a world that was familiar with the lessons from growing plants to cultivating plants, all that stuff. And so sometimes we miss these things, but I want you, through these organic nature of changes, there's four of them that I'm going to point out from Tim Keller, who I'm indebted to. These things you guys can all understand, even if you're like me and you buy your fruit from the store instead of like getting it from a tree, right? But change is gradual. And if you think about that, as we look at the list of the fruit of the Spirit in verse 22, excuse me, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control, those kinds of things do not happen overnight.
The same way a plant, like if you plant like an orange tree or you plant a fig tree, the next day you don't come out and have figs, right? It's gradual. It happens over time. And it takes a lot of cultivation. Now, this is interesting because no matter how good your green thumb is, do you, by your efforts, grow that tree? Not at all. You can't, like, sit there and keep on watering or, like, you know, grab more sun for photosynthesis or, you know, somehow change out the soil every day. In fact, you'll probably kill it. You can overwater. You can underwater. You can do all these things to destroy the growth. However, can you come alongside the natural processes of growth and help it grow? Yes, absolutely. So change is gradual, but we play a part. And this is where I use the word synergism, okay? Synergism means that you work alongside. The prefix syn, S-Y-N, so not S-I-N, but S-Y-N, refers to with, okay? So you work alongside of or with the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit is within you. He's cultivating things within you. He's reminded you of lessons. He's saying, man, you know, when you see that person and your face automatically wants to make that scowl, maybe you shouldn't do that. Or, you know, or when you feel like you want to go and do that thing that you know is contrary to what God wants you to do, here's what I want you to do. And it's the Holy Spirit within you, but it's gradual. And so do not worry if it doesn't happen overnight. In fact, the most beautiful, majestic, wonderful trees and fruits, they often take several seasons to grow. And even within a single planting, you know that there are seasons where it looks like it's not doing a thing, like in winter. And then seasons where it looks like it's growing exponentially and won't be ever stopped, like spring. So we need to know that change is gradual. So don't lose hope. If you feel like you've got more in common with the first list that Paul gives than the second list, the fruit of the Spirit, don't be discouraged. But change is not only gradual, it's also inevitable. And this is the coolest thing to think about. Change is inevitable because if you are God's son, and if the Holy Spirit is within you, which, by the way, the Holy Spirit is within you if you are a Christian. If the Holy Spirit is within you, then change is inevitable. Now, my friend Gary, he does many things in his construction job, but one of the things that he does is foundations and concrete work and masonry. And if you were to, you know, probably go out to one of his sites and kind of look at like an oak tree like seed or that was planted, right? An oak tree versus concrete, like really heavy duty reinforced concrete. Which one's going to win in terms of sheer strength? And you probably say like the concrete. That stuff's pretty hard, right? But as that tree grows, and it grows, and it grows, what happens when the roots grow out? It'll break the concrete, won't it? And it's inevitable that even the hardest heart, when it's changed by God, might not become like a saint overnight. It won't happen overnight. But eventually, the change within you, if you are God's son or if you are God's daughter, will be inevitable. There are going to be certain things that will change. I remember there was a good friend here. He died several years ago, sadly, but Chris Ostrander. I remember before I got here, one of the former elders who moved away, Ray McCormick, said that Chris, he was about to enter into the sanctuary, and Ray said, you know, hey, welcome. You know, why don't you come on? Why don't you come on in? And Chris said to Ray, and I heard the second hand, but Ray had a really good memory. He said, Chris said to him, I'm not sure that I can come in here because honestly, I don't know that I want lightning to strike. And I don't know if I want the whole, you know, house of God to be brought down. Because it's been quite a few years since I've been here and I've done a lot of bad things. And Ray had like a classic answer for him, like, hey, well, you know, we serve a God of forgiveness, so come on it, you know. But what I noticed with his life, even though he had a difficult life, and even though he had many years to practice his own selfishness and his own sort of sin, and I'm not speaking ill of him, I know it's true for me. He nevertheless would come to our men's group. And I'm sure you remember this, Gary, and I'm sure you remember this, Rob, and several others of you who used to come. And he would spout off scripture. like verbatim. And he'd be like, doesn't it say in scripture somewhere? And he would like perfectly. And I was like, yes, it does. Wow, yeah, like that was exactly what Matthew, you know, 24 says. And he was an amazing guy. Change was inevitable for him. It was going to happen. And while I know that he wanted to grow even more before his life was taken, or before he went in an untimely way too soon, I know that he was still even growing then. And although he wanted to grow more, he was just one of those guys that the Holy Spirit changed so indelibly. Change for him was inevitable. And even that hard heart that we all possess, that can be broken, just like the oak tree with its life and its expanding life can break something as hard as concrete. Well, change is also internal. And now, what I mean by this is this, okay? Look at the list again in verse 22, ready? The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Now, are any of those things, thank you so much, Joe. I got a sweat mustache going, and I'm just like, it is hot up here. Are you guys feeling okay? I'm so glad I have to suffer for you guys. So, I'm sweating up here like a pig. God bless you, sir. All right, so notice all those different things, okay? Does any of the list in verses 22 through 23, does any of it have to do with charisma? Does any of it have to do with speaking eloquently? Does any of it have to do with the ability to host a crusade and get like hundreds or maybe even thousands of people to come forward at an invitation? No. Does any of it have to do with singing really well or being really good on stage with an instrument? Does any of it have to do with preaching and teaching? No. None of this is about the gifts of the Spirit. The gifts of the Spirit is a different list. The fruit of the Spirit is what we're talking about today. And get this, okay? Sadly, the history of our last probably 70, 80 years where we have seen the rise and now the fall of the megachurch is mistaking the fruit of the Spirit for the gifts of the Spirit. And here's what I mean. We are seeing more and more and more, and I say this not with glee, I say this sad because I've come from mega churches. I've come from churches where the sheer power of a mobilized group to accomplish something for like a displaced people or a community is so amazing. It's like God is working through that, and I have no doubt that mega churches do some good. But what I see a lot of times is these magnificent speakers, these amazing, eloquent pastors who are complete and utterly spiritually unformed. And so they're like having crazy affairs. Or they're stealing money. Or they're always angry. Or they're whatever it is, the people around them are completely willing to compromise on the fact that they have no integrity, and they have no love, and they have no joy, and they have no peace, and they have no patience or kindness or goodness or faithfulness or gentleness or self-control. But you know what? They're really good at putting rear ends in the pew. So let's bump his pay up. You know what I mean? So what has happened over the years is that we have seen that change should look external because this guy looks like he is the man. He's got a really good-looking family. He drives a really nice car. Everything about him is successful. And then we think, wait a minute, is that really what the example of a fully formed Christian looks like? Someone who is horribly unkind, someone who has like really immature outbursts, someone who is constantly avoiding people because he hates them. I mean, the fruit of the Spirit is internal. And whereas the gifts of the Spirit are important, and all of us, get this, all of us have at least one gift, I really truly believe. I think that all of us possess one gift. But what happens is sometimes we elevate certain other gifts above others. And so people will say, and this saddens me, you know, hey, your gift is more important, Michael, because you're the speaker, or you're this, or whatever. And, you know, I just love, like, I had a friend who was from the South, and he would say, you know, I know that I'm, you know, sort of like part of the family of God, and I'm one of the body parts or the members of God, you know, but, and he was a fundraiser, so he raised money for causes, and he's like, you know, but, you know, people ask me which one I am. I'm not the mouth, I'm not the ear, I don't listen too well, but I'm the armpit, you know, and I loved how he said that, you know, so not all of us are going to be the mouthpiece, but guess what? Can you imagine just a body that's just a big mouth? How odd would that be? We all need each other. And the different gifts that have been given to each other come together so that we can be, as a body, persuasive and winsome to the outside world. But when we speak about the fruit of the Spirit, that's internal. And it's also when we go around someone else. Now, think about this for a second. In Psalm 23, in fact, I'll turn there. You don't need to. But I thought about this as I was reading it to Don Gleason right before he passed away. And I was reading at the very end. Some of you have heard me say this, but it bears repeating. At the very end of Psalm 23 in verse 6, it says this: "Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever." And I always thought that that meant that, you know, God always has goodness and mercy for me. But what I think this has to do with is the fact that wherever God is at, and wherever his people who are formed by him and who are changed by his Holy Spirit and who have the fruit of the Spirit, wherever they are, hey, there's goodness and there's mercy. And it's sort of like, I guess this analogy comes to mind because I'm so hot right now, but it's sort of like, you know, in the peak of summer, when you're going to Target or something like that, right? And you park and you're getting out of your car and your car's hot and you're walking in the sun and the sun's hot. And then all of a sudden you walk through the door and there's that air that just, it pours down on you. You're like, oh. That's the way it should feel to be around a Christian. Think about that. It should feel, in a word, refreshing to be around people. But all too often, because we're so consumed with the external and the gifts of the Spirit, being around those kinds of people can be exhausting because their ego fills the room and it's all about them. Rather than, man, I was around that person and they didn't strike me as the most eloquent speaker. They're not the most, you know, perfect in this area, but you know what? Gosh, they were gentle, they were loving, they were peaceful, they were joyful, they were patient. Gosh, that means that the Spirit has formed you, and that's pretty amazing. So change is internal. We shouldn't look always to the externals. And yes, God does bless certain people with amazing gifts, and we should honor that. But it's not always the case, and what we should be focusing on is how we individually are being formed. Now, finally, at least for this list, change is also symmetrical. Now, what is meant by this? When we talk about change being symmetrical, think about fruit, or think about food, for instance. Like, how many of you know any foodies, right? Raise your hand. Like, you know, people who are super into eating out. Oh, man, you guys need to have more fun. I know one right there. Titus, man. Titus, you're a foodie, and I always ask him for recommendations on good places to eat, because he knows, like, he's got the inside scoop. He's the man. So when it comes to, like, eating good food or having, you know, whatever it is, you guys know that you want your experience to be symmetrical. Here's what I mean, right? It would almost be easier if I used a different analogy, but you guys aren't over 21, so I can't use the analogy of drinking wine. So I won't use that one. But have you ever heard someone talk about, like, if they take a bite of something, that it was really good up front, and then the aftertaste was awful, right? You know what I'm talking about? If you eat something really good, or if you drink something really good, it's not just good the first taste, the first impression, and it's not just good while you're, you know, eating it or swishing it around or whatever, it's also good after you finish it. In a word, it's symmetrical. And so here's how it relates to the fruit of the Spirit. You ready? If you were to eat a fruit, and if you were to have an apple or a fig or whatever it was, and you ate the first bite, and then it was terrible afterwards, you know it's not symmetrical. And so when you look at someone, or you look at even your own life, the fruit of the Spirit should be symmetrical insofar as perhaps you're like a really loving person. Perhaps you're sort of like the person who's super laid back, and you're like, I don't know, boys will be boys. Like, let's just, you know, have fun. Everyone, I love everyone. But you have no self-control. That's not symmetrical, is it? Because eventually you'll get to the point where you might be overeating or overdrinking, or you might be allowing people around you to take advantage of you, or you might, you know, not be in the shape that you need for God to be able to use you. So the fruit of the Spirit is encouraging us to be symmetrical, and it's not elevating one particular fruit above the other. Love is, of course, preeminently important, but in the name of love, I can do certain things that would actually be injustice on a bigger scale. Would you agree? Like, if I'm like, you know what, you know, Luke has been really on like a spree lately where he just runs up and steals money out of people's purses. But you know what? Boys will be boys, and I love them, so I'm not going to do anything. Like, that's injustice, right? I think so. So I hope that you guys understand that ultimately what this is about is that everything sort of within us is at least gradually inclined to improve so that we become more and more conformed into the image and the stature of Jesus, which is what Paul talks about in almost all of his other epistles. It's not just about one fruit, it's about all of them together. And it's about all of them creating within us a flavor profile, if you will, so that it's not just like, man, that guy was really lovely, but he was like really, like, oh, it was awful being around him. Or, man, that guy was really self-controlled, but he was like a complete prude. It was awful being around him. He wasn't even gracious at all. It's all of those things together. So we understand what change is like. Huh, how do we actually change? And I want to conclude with this. Number one, how do we actually change? I think we move on from the past. Look at verse 24 with me. And those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Now, the word for crucify, stauro, is an interesting Greek word. It actually has, it's not, and hear me carefully, okay, because Easter's coming up, and inevitably some of you will watch The Passion of the Christ. The Passion of the Christ is a good movie, but it's not like perfectly spot on. Can you imagine Hollywood got some things wrong? So the reason why I don't think it's spot on is this. Movie elevates Jesus' physical punishment on the cross, and no doubt that that was excruciating. It elevates that to the detriment of what first century Jews would have actually thought about, and that was Jesus' shame on the cross. If you read all across the Bible, one of the reasons why the Jews did not believe in Jesus was because there is no way that the Messiah could actually be put to shame like that. Not only that, Hebrews chapter 12 talks about he despised the shame and he went forward on the cross. There's all kinds of verses about the shame that Jesus endured in order to go through the punishment of the cross. So whereas it was awful that he had endured that physical punishment, there were also thousands and thousands of other criminals that endured crucifixion. So let's not think merely about the physical punishment. Instead, let's think about the fact that when we conceive of crucifixion, it has to do with shaming or projecting onto things that they are shameful. Because as we read this verse, verse 24, and those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. I used to read that as if, you know what I'm doing to my passions and desires? I am killing them. Just, you know, like stamping them and then just going like that. Well, what's the problem with that? I still grapple with those passions and desires, right? If you're living a life, if you, like, If you have a life where you're spending 40, 50, even 60 years practicing your sinfulness, and I say practicing intentionally, like you are giving yourself over to your own passions and lusts, when you give your life to Jesus at a later age, you don't just suddenly go, well, that's great. Now I don't like feel like that anymore. Yes, you might quit smoking. Awesome. Yes, you might quit drinking, and you should. That's great. But change is gradual, as we've just established. And not only that, when you think about, like, hey, I'm just going to mercilessly crucify, you know, and kill my passions and desires, it makes it seem like it's just some easy checklist. Like, just do that, boom, and you're done. Instead, if you think about it like this, I'm going to, like, ready? I'm going to shame my passions and lusts. I'm going to assign to those things that they have no value in my life, that they're disgusting, that they're awful, and that I want to have nothing to do with them. I think that's a more viable long-term solution. And not only that, the tense of the verse to crucify in verse 24 is this. Ready? It's daily or continually. Daily or continually, you should crucify the flesh. So this is something that is ongoing, where you project upon the things that you are grappling with as if they have no value to you. You remember how you felt when you gave yourself over. You remember how it feels to be in bondage. You remember how it feels to feel the weight of the sin on your shoulders, and you say, I want to have nothing to do with that. But not only that, guys, we move on from the past because at times, and I think this is possibly more important, at times it is possible that we make an idol of our past sins. And this is really important because I don't think anyone really intentionally does this, but it's very possible for us to say, man, I've messed up so bad. I've done this so many times. And then we define ourselves by what we've done. Like, I am an adulterer, or I am, you know, a murderer, or I am this or that, and we define ourselves by what we've done, rather than saying, hey, those things, man, they've been crucified. Like, they're with Christ. In other words, like, they can no longer be used as a basis of accusation by the enemy against me. As far as the east is from the west, that's how far he separated my sin. So I'm going to move on from it. I'm not going to dwell on it. I'm going to crucify it in that sense. Does that make sense? That's a really important point. So move on from the past. And more importantly, number two, dwell in the Spirit. Look at verse 25 with me. If we live by the Spirit, let us also walk by the Spirit. Now, I misspoke. I actually said that have crucified was in the present tense and that it was daily or continually. Forgive me, I misspoke there. What I meant to say was, let us also walk in the Spirit. Or in some versions, it says, let us also keep step with the Spirit. That's actually in the present tense. So forgive me, I made a mistake there. But when it talks about walking in the Spirit, I want you to think about this. You ready? Now, I realize that not has had this experience. Is my mic going in and out? It is? Okay. I just want to make sure. I think, yep, I got enough battery here. I just want to make sure you guys can still hear me, okay? Very good. Okay, thank you. So I took this picture off the internet, you know, and you could see here, these are people in their dress uniform marching, but there's something really amazing about marching together when you're in the military. Those of you who have had that experience, you know what I'm talking about. You can almost lose yourself within the whole. And it's a really cool thing because you got one person calling a cadence and everyone else falling in line. They're keeping in step with one another. Now, if you were to go to chaplain school is like a start of a bad joke. You ready? It's like a rabbi, an imam, a priest, and a pastor go to army training school. Like, it's really funny because these are not like the most elite special forces soldier. These are people like me who are just going over and like they want to learn how to minister in the army. But eventually they take these people who are all from different traditions and different walks of life and they say, this is the direction we're going and this is how you'll get there. And they call a cadence and we fall in line. And the crazy thing is, inevitably, someone will be marching along and will get out of step. And what you have to do there is a little, it's funny, you just kind of hop and you get back in, and then you're back in step with everyone else. And I think that what Paul is getting at here is, hey, as you crucify and you put on the cross your passions and lusts, and those things creep back into your life, what do you have to do? Do you have to mortify yourself and say, oh, wretched man that I am? You know, do you have to stay away from church because lightning's going to strike you? No, all you have to do is get back in step with the Holy Spirit. And you need to keep on going, and you need to keep on distancing yourself from those things. Keep in step with the Spirit, and as you do that, you become more and more like the people that you associate with. You become more and more formed as you spend more time with Jesus. Now, Jesus said this as we close very quickly. He said this, I am the vine and you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that will bear much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. So what does it mean to keep in step with the Spirit? Well, very quickly, it means things like this. Paul says elsewhere at the conclusion of his epistles, hey, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Isn't it great that he didn't say, read your Bible every day for 15 minutes, and if you're really spiritual, 20. Like, he doesn't say that, right? Because then we'd be like, oh, man, I failed, you know? Does he say, listen to 4 worship songs, no less, every day? No, he doesn't. He says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Isn't that a wonderful way? And you could do that not only through reading your Bible, maybe through listening to your Bible or listening to praise music, reminding yourselves of the truths that are encapsulated in the songs that you listen to. It's a really wonderful thing. He also says this, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is of good repute, think on those things. In other words, change your mindset. In Romans chapter 12, he talks about renewing your mind. And not only that, he talks about how in other places, like just the reminder of what God has made, his majestic creation, can remind you of how great he is. And so I don't have to have a Bible when I'm at the Grand Canyon to reflect on God's greatness. All I need is the Grand Canyon because it's amazing. Or seeing a little baby and a little baby for the first time. I don't need to have my Bible out to remind myself of how majestic God is. All I need to do is think about, wow, that was in my wife's stomach for 9 months, and now it's here. This is amazing. So letting the word of Christ dwell in you richly is more than simply just reading scripture, although it does mean that. It means that you're keeping in step with the Spirit, that you're surrounding yourself with people who are also in step with the Spirit. Dwayne, you talked about the men's ministry, and ladies, you have a wonderful women's ministry and small groups, and all those are ways that you can keep in step with the ministry. And so finally, as we conclude our take-home truth, I want to ask you this question, and I want to ask myself this question too. Am I growing? Now, does that mean that I'm asking the same thing as, have I arrived? No, not at all. But gradually, over time, are you growing? And if you're not, you need to ask yourself that question. And I don't say this to guilt you. Please don't hear it that way. But ask yourself, am I a Christian? Have I committed myself to the Lord? And if you are a Christian, but you feel like you're not growing, ask yourself this question. Am I abiding? Am I keeping in step with the Spirit? Because all of us can have more and more of the Spirit and more of letting the word of Christ dwell within us richly. Let me pray for us as we respond to the truth of God that we just heard in a great song. Lord, thank you for this day and this time. Lord, help us to be more and more conformed to the image of your Son, not based on the temple model and trying harder, but working alongside of the Holy Spirit so that we might become more inclined to the things that you have for us. Thank you for your Son, Jesus, and for the fact that we ultimately know that on the next side, on the other side of heaven, we will become exactly like him. But on this side, help us not lose sight to the fact that you haven't just saved us from hell. If that's all you did, that's more than we deserve. But you've also given us this life so that we can become more and more like you. So thank you for that fact. Change us, conform us, in your name, amen. Today's benediction comes from Ephesians chapter 1 at verse 18. So maybe in a posture of reception, would you receive this morning's benediction because it comes directly from the Spirit. It comes from the Spirit of God given to us through the revelation given to Apostle Paul. And it says this, may the eyes of your heart be enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which he has called you. and what are the riches of his glorious inheritance to the saints. So go in grace and peace, brothers and sisters. Thank you so much for worshiping with us, and I hope you have a blessed rest of your day. Rest, God of-